What's going on, guys? Tyson Anderson, Mr. Hammer Down. Listen, guys, would you or should you breed dogs with an underbite? Let's dig right in. Well,
would you breed a dog with an underbite?
It honestly depends. I've had people ask me this quite often. A dog with an underbite, first of all, it depends on how bad the underbite is. If we're talking hairline, fracture, a hairline underbite, versus it's almost even, or it's just barely passed, right? Versus, you know, English bulldog. Would I? I would if the circumstances called for me to do so. Only time you should breed a dog with an underbite, or let me, I don't want to overstep. Only time I would breed a dog with an underbite is if that dog is very, very monumental, critical, and paramount to my breeding program and to the furthering and the bettering and the sustaining and maintaining of a family of dogs behind that dog. If I had other options, sisters, brothers, to go around that and sort of alternate the usage and the implementation or the implementing of that dog with the underbite, I would not. I, as a matter of fact, I'm reminded a gentleman I sold a dog to. He was a friend of mine. I tried to be a friend. I know he's down in Louisiana. I can't think of the guy's name, but the dog is a full mate to my Bart dog, and I think the gentleman actually had the dog up for sale a couple days ago. And that's neither here nor there. But the thing is, it struck me because, you know, that to me, a dog with an underbite isn't expendable. Because I have of that particular line, I have more of that. So I don't need that dog. And it wasn't until it was brought to my attention that I was like, huh, would I breed that dog? Would I breed that dog? Do I need to breed that dog? Do I need to obtain that dog? And the answer is no. You have to stand firm on the decisions that you make. And I knew what I was doing and what I got into when I withdrew my hand from that particular dog because the underbite is that bad. It's English bulldog bite. And I'm only bringing that in because it actually plays into what I'm talking about right now. So it serves some relevance, right? I would not in this sense because I have that particular dog's sister, her brothers, and I essentially could recreate that all over again. You see what I'm saying? I have the mother, and I don't need to have the father when I've got the sons and dogs that are different variants of that bloodline's temperature. I can easily at any time adjust and set the thermostat to what I need. And so I don't, you know, I'm not having to. So no, I wouldn't in this situation. But if I was desperate and I was in a situation where I absolutely had nothing else to fall back on, I didn't have the various variants to establish or to be forced to reconsider. If I didn't have to do that, then I would breed that dog. So to answer that question, I would in that sense, and I would not in the other sense. So it's twofold. It's twofold. And we have to stick to the guns of that. So,
should you breed a dog with an underbite?
Should you? Again, I have to answer that question according to a breeder's lens, or from the visual or perspective of a breeder's lens, right through my eyes as a breeder. I would say, man, look, no, there's no way. Don't use that. Don't do this. Don't do that. When you say, would I, personal, should you, or should I, asking the question, maybe putting on someone else's kennel, no, you shouldn't, unless you're in a desperate situation to reclaim and recover, to sustain and maintain that particular family. Overall, you shouldn't. Largely. Why? Because whatever you put inside that gene pool, you cannot breed out. You can reduce, you can descale, you can minimize, you can suppress, you can submerge, you can camouflage, but you'll never push out ultimately that's in the gene. If it's mouthiness, you can breed dogs and bring dogs in to correct. But somewhere in there, if you 30 years from now, that off bark, that extra bark, it'll come right back in just a breeding. What, you know, I'm sorry, should I, should you? Again, I spoke to various people, and I believe Mr. Kenneth Racine of the Birch Lake Beagles in Ishpeming, Michigan, and I was going to bring that in and as an audio clip, but he said he doesn't care if the dogs have 5 feet, 3 eyes, underbite, whatever, fan tail, long as they can run in the front and do it right. He doesn't care about size, color, look, anything. As long as they're through the course 13 for him, because that's what he runs. I understand. Ish. Because he's a competitor primarily. I believe Mr. Racine, I don't quote me on this because it's been so long. I think it's over a year since I gave this brief video or audio, audible interview. He said, he believes in breeding running styles to running styles. Okay. All right. I believe in breeding families to families. And if the family to the family does not complement the family, I don't believe in bringing that about. Okay. I think the answers on should you breed a dog with an underbite, I think the answer should be no. Because you're going to have too many different denominators. You're going to have too many different ailing factors. Not aiding, ailing. You're going to have too many liabilities in the courts of breeding a dog with an underbite, guys and gals, ladies and gents. By all means, do what you want. They're your dogs. But if you're going to better the breed, you don't better the breed by putting in or breeding defective parts and counterparts. You know, if you're a candle maker and a candle's wick is underneath the candle surface, as you're in that assembly line, it's up to that quality control manager or whomever, overseer, that's overseeing that situation or entity or enterprise, that in the production part of it, while it's being made, before it hits the market, to catch that flawed candle. Well, an underbite is a flaw. It is a defective piece or part in that gene, and in that gene pool. And you can't get around that. There's no way around it. The only way around that, now you can, let's say this, and I'll build this problem and I'll let you go, because I don't want to bore you guys. Some of you guys really want this, and some guys are just like, man, I'm in it to see that you kill rabbits. I don't want to hear your intellect and what you have going on, what you want to do. But some people do. So pardon me, I'm for the people that want to hear this. Here's the thing. Let's say you had dog A, okay, that's the female. Dog B is a sister. Dog C is a sister. Dog D is a sister, right? Dog E is a brother. There was five, right? There was a male and four females. Dog A is the best of all, but she's got an underbite. B, C, and D are females that are almost as good, perfected, no underbite, no defect, no deficiency, no flaw, right? In their physical feature and anatomy. But their performance is just not as good as dog A. Well, you have dog E, who is a male. You can take dog E, being the male, and you can breed off of him and produce counterparts that are females. If you are to intensely breed off of him, you've got half of what you started with, because if it's off of him, dog E is only going to be able to produce half of that pool. So now you got nieces to the dogs of A through D. So they're only half of what the dog A was, but you may have perfected something. Well, if you line bred or you inbred all of that male dog, and you were able to strengthen that lineup of that family of dogs A through E, right? Because you're after the dog that's like dog A without the bite, underbite. Dog E may be able to produce dog F, being the female and the niece to dog A through the dogs A through D, may be able to produce that and have it concentrated to the point where you've got enough to say it's of the family of dogs A through E. But you've got enough of an outcross to call it a revamped version of dogs A through E. You see? So now this dog is in its own playing field. It's still representing the family of dogs A through E, but it's representing the families from a bettered point of view. You see? So largely, you shouldn't breed a dog with an underbite just because you're trying to better the breed. But from a minority and a smaller scale point of view, you should. If the situation or circumstances call for you to do so, again, there's many folds here. Some people get so in a hurry and say, man, this dog is off of field champion, international field champion, national large pack champion, little pack rapid champion, world champion, world state run off of this, that, woo! And they do that. They use that. No regard of the dog's bodies. No regard of the dog's jaws and any of that, right? Because they're looking for the ribbon. I think if we paid attention to detail, you'll see that we're really not that far from perfection from the place of where we would be if we started really honing in to our craft and say, you know what, I have to maximize the time I have, because tomorrow isn't promised. So you breed just like you live every day as if it's your last. What if this? What if this is your last chance to better the beagle breed, or whatever genre you have? What if this is your last litter? What if this is your last chance? What if this is your first stand? What do you do? How do you breed? Guys, this is my take on would you or should you, would I breed a dog with an underbite? I hate if I didn't touch on everything that you guys may have wanted me to, because I didn't want to go into the science of this and that too much. I want to sort of stay on the surface, because I don't want to get too far off into this whole tangent where it's not helpful. You know, I think the basics is what we have to get back to. So we have to relay the foundation of the basics. We've got so modern and modularized in that, you know, grain scope of that coat of many colors that we forget about just basic black and white. Not purple, yellow, silver, earth tone, turquoise, this and that, pink, just black, white. You know, nothing to do with race. I'm talking about principle, moral, standard, black, white. Call a spade, ace of ace. Heart of heart, king of king, you know. And I think if we stick to that, we'll see better in the numbers. We'll see better in the performances. We'll see better in the sustaining of that mobile family of dogs. You have the objective in breeding is to keep the family mobile, moving, not stagnant or slowing down. We don't want to do that. We want this thing to be moving. Sometimes you make a breeding to slow it up. Hey, pull back the rein. Sometimes you make a breeding to speed it up. And I'm not talking about speed. I'm talking about efficiency. Effectiveness. If you want to be efficient, you have to pay attention to what you're putting together from the male and the female all the way back into as far as you can see. That's why it pays to study. You could be doubling up, and I'm closing. You could be doubling up, tripling up, quadrupling up, watch this, on negative genes, right? And by implementing that dog with an underbite, here's why it's important. Six generations back, the whole family could have had underbites. And then somebody somewhere went outside of the family and began to make intricate relationships with these new endeavors to try to change that warpness in the physical countenance of that family. And then it went even bite from here to even to scissor. And then somewhere along the line, the gene popped itself up again. And then it went from here to barely to hairlines, like right there on top, to scissor, to now reverting back to the old cause. Pay attention to the details of what the dogs show you in every breeding. So when you're faced with this question, it could be shyness, it could be this, it could be that, it could be a mousy head, a little ear. But in this particular situation and segment, we're talking about the underbite. We have to know what to do when these alarming things pop up inside our coming forth. And some of us don't know what to do. Nobody ever told me, hey, look, wait, whoa, wait, hold on. Think about this. So this is just a thought. I'm casting a thought, a hypothetical thought, and hypothetical thoughts before you. I'm a student. I only know what I know, and I can only teach what I know. In this segment, I'm just sharing light and shedding light on an ailing situation that has not ever served beneficial to the breeder. So here it is. Would you or should you breed a dog with an underbite? If you haven't paid attention to the video, if you catch the tail end, play it back two or three times, listen to what I'm saying. Hear what I'm saying, take it into consideration, and then go out there and make that evaluation. If you have dogs in your kennel and they have underbites throughout there, hey, you may like that. Who knows? Maybe they do groundwork good. Maybe they retrieve better. I don't know, you know, so I know me, I don't want that. So it's all on what you want. Breed what you want. Call what you want, keep what you want, feed what you want. It's all in what you want. It's all preference, ma'am. It's all preference, woman. It's all preference, sir. It's all preference, ma'am. But until next time, Tyson Anderson, Mr. Hammerdown, we'll see you when we see you. Oh. And I almost forgot. Stay tuned for the next segment. I may release it in the next day or two. It's going to be called Standing the Test Time. Cash my check, clean my truck, put on my hat, forgot about work. Sun going down, head across town, pick up my baby, turn it around. Good time. Oh, I need a good time.